Holy Father has said that sermons, homilies, should be no more than 10 minutes. So, taking that august advice, I'll try my best. And let's start with a vicar story. Imagine you are a vicar. Someone knocks on your door late at night. A lad that you know. One of your regular churchgoers, 17, 18 years old, his head's buzzing with religious thoughts, things that he's never come to mind before, experiences, encounters. He's wanting to tell everybody about it. He doesn't know how to do it. It's like someone beginning to learn fire juggling. What do? Send him away? Tell him to come back at more social hours? I leave that with you. Have a think. I'll come back to it in a minute. Because there are going to be people who come through our doors, who come in the midst of this place, and want an explanation. There are going to be people who come into our midst who are wanting to put into words what our help to do that. Because God is stirring something up in them. There are going to be people who need an interpreter. And we shouldn't be surprised, should we? Because these encounters, as unnerving as they may be for us as members of a congregation, are what we're about. That's our business. The supernatural, Jesus, God, faith. That's what we're about. Now, returning to that vicar story, the young lad who knocks on the door. I want to say it is a true story. It happened. The lad is real. He's standing before you. It's me. And that priest from Ivy Bridge really saved me on a number of occasions. Indeed, when I look back, I realise he was doing that for a number of years, quietly, since we first started worshipping at that church when I was about 12 years old. Now, to start off with, I didn't mind going to church on a Sunday. In fact, I found it quite alluring and mysterious and magical. However, my folks thought I should go to church wearing my school uniform. This was intolerable. I rebelled, I sulked, I really sort of put up quite a fight. And the priest in his infinite wisdom came up with a solution. He said, if I served at the altar, if I became an altar boy, then it didn't really matter what I wore underneath these robes, did it? That was a little concern. Thank you, Father Douglas. So began a path to vocation. I'm here because I didn't want to wear my school uniform. I'd say as a child growing up in the 1970s and the 1980s, it gradually dawned on me that something was up in this whole business of religion, that something had happened in the 1960s or so, where sort of Britain and Jesus seemed to be parting ways, and churches were declining. It had become a rupture. I don't know. What happened? Can you tell me? But by the 1970s, it seemed normalised. We took it for granted that churches were becoming empty, that Jesus was less at the centre of our religious, of our national life. Two other sort of personal instances come to mind. The first is at the age of 9, and on Facebook, if you don't believe how bad my haircut was, I've put a picture on there of my school photo at 9. At 9, my folks had not been going to church for a number of years. They started going, as I mentioned earlier on, when I was in my teens. But on lazy Sunday afternoons and mornings, I often wandered into the local church. At that time, we were living in Uggborough, and I would would creep into the back of the church and watch services. We lived next to the church as it was, so it was an easy climb over our garden fence into the building. I never really understood much what was going on, and sometimes I'd stand at the back with Hymns Ancient and Modern. Do you remember that red book, pretending to sing hymns? Occasionally a Sunday school teacher would come up to me and tap me on the shoulder and invite me to do some colouring upstairs. I would give her the dirty look. I was going to stand there and pretend and do hymns. No one was going to stop me. At secondary school, I can remember another vivid instance of realising that religion in our land was going through problems and issues. An RE teacher asked for a show of hands as to who went to church, and without thinking, I put my hand up. That was an interesting type of playground an hour later, as I was the only one. And again, I still had the Amish haircut, and lacked streetwise, still do. I began to think, why am I the only one going to church and sort of liking it, and why aren't my contemporaries going? I could totally sympathise with Paul writing to the church in Corinth in his second epistle, saying there's a sense in which the nations are veiled. There's like a veil over them. They can't see what our faith is about. So the God of this world has veiled their eyes to the truth of the gospel. And that's exactly how it felt and still does feel. Now, 11 years ago, almost to the day that Father Douglas passed away, a great friend, he looked after me in so many ways, particularly when my adopted grandfather passed away. He was there within minutes. He decided in my 20s that I needed a religious education, so he took me round to various places of pilgrimage to the world, to Rome. You know, if someone has been to Rome recently, to the Holy Land, to all over the place, Lourdes, to Poland, to Assisi. It was inspirational to have a friend and mentor like that. And in fact, I presided at his funeral. It was in the remote outskirts of Exeter, a balmy location at which church. That the lanes were quite narrow, just getting to the church itself. I preached and read 2 Kings 2, Elisha asking, if I could have anything, I'd like a double portion of your grace. Because that's how it felt here, you know. At a poignant moment during the funeral, we placed a chalice and a paten on the coffin. And then at the end of the funeral, those instruments of priesthood were taken to the altar, giving it back to God. I remember reflecting at the time that should it come to my own funeral, I'd like something like that. But I'd like to be able to take it sort of one step further and give my ordination charitable, my mantle to someone. Won't be giving anything, she said. I'd like to pass that on. But I hope that in my own ministry, I can keep that promise that I remember in my 20s, that thought, I've got to pass this on. And the work that we've been doing with St. Peter's and others, I hope is in the spirit of what was given to me. We all need an interpreter. And if the church isn't about that, what is it about? I must be coming near to that 10 minutes because I can see David Parks nodding. Often often it's hard to know what to do with when someone comes to you with this, but that's our business. This is our core work, and if we're not about this, what on earth are we about? We must never be too busy. We must be ready to give interpretation. Amen. Going to carry on now with the service and say together the